go out to the New York Association for Psychiatric Rehabilitation Services, to the Mental Health Empowerment Project and the Empowerment Exchange, Families Together in New York State, and Youth Power, as well as IEAR, and last but certainly not least, the Sanctuary for Independent Media. And all of you. So what we're going to do now, and by the way, that last film won the best short at the Mad in America International Film Festival, which took place in October and was totally an awesome experience. And I'll just let me recommend the Mad in America website. Pretty easy to remember. Bob Whitaker, who was in the Beyond the Medical Model, is that's kind of his website. And he also has a book that you might want to read, you should read, Anatomy of an Epidemic. Okay, so I'm going to introduce our two panelists. Sera Davidow is a mother, an advocate, an activist, and a filmmaker, as you know. She devotes much of her time to the Western Massachusetts Recovery Learning Community, which includes AFIA, the 13th peer respite in the United States. You can ask her about that. She's also an active part of Hearing Voices USA and Occupy the Judge Rottenberg Center, amongst a variety of other projects. She herself entered the mental health system as a teenager and cites noncompliance, as she said, as a part of what saved her from a very different path through life that surely would not have included the freedom she now enjoys from all psychiatric labels and medications. And then we also have Sascha Altman DuBrul, co-founder of the Icarus Project, which was with Jacks McNamara, the subject of the first film, Crooked Beauty. The Icarus Project, as he will tell us about, but I'll just read this, is a radical community support network and media project that is actively redefining the language and culture of mental health and illness. He's the author of Maps to the Other Side, The Adventures of a Bipolar Cartographer, a document of one person's odyssey to transform his experiences navigating the psychiatric system by building community in the face of adversity, a set of maps for how rebels and dreamers can survive and thrive in a crazy world. And Sasha's here today from New York City, thanks to the fact that he is at a training with the Western Mass RLC. That's the only reason he was able to come. So the way this is going to work is I'm going to ask three questions of both of the panelists, and we'll have relatively short answers, and then we'll open it up to questions, comments, discussion. So the first question is about personal story. What happened? What did you experience? And how was it transformative? In like 3 minutes, you know.
Yeah, there's no short answer to that.
Say what you will.
I had already started to tell you before Beyond the Medical Model that at some point in my teen years, I knew I was having a really hard time, and I landed in front of my first therapist, and they gave me my first diagnosis, and I thought it was helpful initially. And I sort of went with it. I'm like, okay, you know, this is an answer I hadn't had before. And then things got so much worse. You know, I was taking the medication I was supposed to be taking, and I was sort of, and I was, you know, buying into all this, and it got worse. And I started this sort of routine of running and hiding. And I, you know, funnily enough, I made my way into college. But when you're in college and you stop showing up, they don't keep you there. So that kicked me into a run to Florida, where I kind of had a transformative moment, which was a therapist in front of me with a book in front of her face asking me how often I drank and had sex and who I was having sex with and how often I was hurting and cutting and burning myself and all these things that were going on in my life. And then she put the book down and she said, okay, you are generalized anxiety disorder, major depression, bulimia, and borderline personality disorder. And that was the point at which I pretty much said, I don't know you very well, I don't know how you feel about swearing, but I pretty much said, fuck you. And the thing is, I didn't say it out loud, but it was a transformative moment in my head because I knew that I wasn't going to continue to find the answers in this particular system. There's lots more that I could tell you, but that really set me on a path of figuring out who I was and realizing that they weren't asking me any of the right questions. And had they asked me the right questions, they would have learned that I experienced all this physical and emotional and sexual abuse in my childhood. And, you know, maybe, just maybe, that had something to do with how I'd come to be in this world and was part of my struggle. So I'm going to leave it at that. Well, they did say that, but no.
Thank you.
First of all, I just want to say it's great to be here, and it's really, this is a really sweet space, and you all seem really great. So similar to Sera and a lot of other people, I had my first encounter with the psychiatric system as a teenager, you know, when I was a freshman in college. It was real dramatic, though. It's a dramatic story. And actually, this is what I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to try and condense it really short. It's like a story about a story. Because the story is that when I was 18 years old, the police found me walking on the subway tracks in New York City, and I thought that the world was about to end and that I was being broadcast live on primetime television on all the channels. I thought that there was microscopic transmitters implanted under my skin, recording my thoughts for some top secret branch of the CIA. And, you know, the cops wrestled me to the ground, put me in a jail cell, and then I ended up in Bellevue Psychiatric Hospital where they got a court order to forcefully medicate me, and I got shot up with a drug called Haldol, and then woke up like 2 weeks later in the quiet room of a public mental hospital. That was the beginning of my story, okay? Now, the thing is that story that I just told you is part of a story that I ended up writing when I was 27 years old after being hospitalized a number of times and diagnosed with bipolar disorder. And the story that I have for you, basically, like the most interesting part, you know, that I could think to impart to you in this short amount of time we have, is that what I did was by telling my story publicly, writing it down and having it published, all these people read it and were like, whoa, I had a really similar experience to that guy, and ended up writing to me. And that is how we ended up starting the Icarus Project website. So if you watched Crooked Beauty, Jacks McNamara was one of the people that initially wrote to me and sent me this like outrageously beautiful, brilliant message. And I was like, who is this person? And the night we met, we stayed up, you know, till 3 a.m. and decided to start a website called the Icarus Project. So there you go. There's my story.
Thank you. The next question is about the organizations. So what is your organization? How does it function, or what does it do? And how is that different than other organizations? What's kind of creative, unique, effective, empowering, I don't know, all of the above? And you have a little bit more time. You don't have to be quite that fast.
Okay. So I'm actually just going to start by saying I came to this, I think a lot of people who work in the traditional mental health system go there as well because they have had their own experiences. And so that's where I landed first. I landed in a traditional role in a provider system, and I was managing to keep all this stuff separate. And I was doing a really good job at keeping it all separate, but it was taking a lot of energy. And at one point, when by the way, I was being told that I had all this clinical expertise and I was really awesome. They didn't use exactly those words, but that's basically what they were saying. And then I got to a point where I kind of couldn't pass anymore. I'd just had a baby, my house fell apart because my pipes froze, and I just couldn't do it. While I was on leave, I thought it'd be a really good idea to come out and put it on the web and have all my story out there. And surprisingly, shockingly to you, I'm sure, within a few days, they were wondering if I was competent to return to my job. And I ended up losing that job, but it was really good timing because there was these early conversations happening about this thing that would be called the Recovery Learning Community. So 2 years before it got funded, I got to be involved in developing the vision of what this community would be. And it was going to be really important that it was a community, not just some center somewhere. People call us the Recovery Learning Center, and it kind of freaks us out because we're this community wherever we are. And this grew, this community that really, it started in 2007 and grew really fast. And I was lucky to be able to come in a leadership role with it and really support it to grow. And at this point, the way we talk about it is having these four arms, and I have a creepy graphic that's really memorable to go along with the four-arm idea. And we have a training and consultant arm, and we have a advocacy and activism arm. I was just with some of the people in this room over in Albany at a protest last week, you know, doing advocacy around the Murphy Bill. We have an alternative healing practices arm and then a peer-to-peer support arm. There's lots of stuff that I could talk about in those, but one of the things that I will say is what's been really great about this community is watching people come into it, find themselves, and find their voice and make the community grow. That's a key. There wasn't a vision. There was a vision, but not a vision of exactly what it became. And what so much of what it has become is about who's come to it and how they've found their voice and what that voice has meant to our community and what it's brought. So some of the things it's led us to are things like the Hearing Voices movement. I don't know if that's familiar to you, but in the United Kingdom, particularly the Hearing Voices movement has gotten really big. It's about people who experience hearing voices or having visions or other unusual experiences, not necessarily being told they have to get rid of those voices or that those voices are necessarily bad, but being supported to figure out what they do mean for them. So we had people who grew up in our community to feel that that was really important. And now we're one of the only places in the country that are offering nationally facilitator trainings for hearing voices. And we supported Hearing Voices USA to develop, and that's a growing organization as well. We also have something called Alternatives to Suicide training, which is actually what Sascha is here doing. And that is one of the only peer-to-peer groups that I'm aware of that is really about focusing on people struggling with thoughts around killing themselves. It's historically been seen as, oh, one person who wants to kill themselves talking to another person who wants to kill themselves is a really bad idea. But we're finding actually two people or a group of people who are experiencing those ideas who are ready to sit with each other through that and not press the panic button is a really big deal and can really make a difference. It's not rocket science. It's about being with people. But that's one of the things that has just developed through the wisdom that has come from so many people in our community and their experience.
You want to talk about AFIA?
That's what I was going to say. Tracy mentioned AFIA. And AFIA is a peer-to-peer respite. I think the word peer gets trivialized into some sort of weird identity that is synonymous with consumer or client or any of those other words that I refuse to identify by. But it's about this way of being with one another that is really just about supporting people to explore and figure out how have you come to be in this world? And is it working for you? What isn't working for you? What do you want to move toward? And so we have this house in Northampton, Massachusetts, that is an alternative for people who are trying to avoid hospitalization. So people come in really intense places who sometimes are being threatened with forced hospitalization, and they can stay there for up to a week, and they can be around other people who have been through similar experiences, but more importantly, are willing to sit with them, no matter how strange the things they are saying might sound to the average person on the street, and really just continue to be with them and not get freaked out if they're talking about killing themselves or hurting themselves or any of that, and just move through. And the thing is, so many people are afraid of what happens when you don't intervene, but we see really powerful things happen when you're just willing to be with people. I don't know if you know this, but the studies that are out there say that the highest risk of suicide is directly after someone's been released from a hospital. And there's some new research out there that is saying that I'm forgetting momentarily the statistic, but if you've been hospitalized by force in the last year, your risk of killing yourself is just enormous, absolutely enormous. I think it's like 40.3 times greater if that's happened to you in the last year. So these are critical supports that don't look like much to sometimes to clinical people who are used to having really clear interventions that you have to do, but they're the kinds of things I think that are changing people's lives. And we like to say we're working on changing the world, so.
Thank you. Tell us about Icarus.
First, I'll just say I'm so inspired by the work that Sera and Western Mass RLC does. I mean, it's just, especially for the last few days I've been in this training, and it's just been getting to be in this community of people and seeing what happens when there's people all living in the same place. A lot of the work I end up doing is, it's national work, so I end up communicating with a lot of people all over the place, and we don't have a solid base of people in New York. All right, so what does Icarus do? So when we started the Icarus Project, we started with the vision that we were going to change the language and the culture of what gets called mental health and mental illness. That's the place that we started from, you know? And the way we did that initially was we created a website and we put a bunch of forums on it. And we put forums on it that were different than any of the other forums that were on, you know, online out there. So we had forums like alternate dimensions or psychotic delusions, you know, where, you know, you saw there was like a piece in the film about spiritual emergence and spiritual emergency. It's a very different thing. Let me tell you, as someone who has been through some pretty intense stuff in my life, being able to talk to other people who have been through similar stuff makes me feel so much less alone in the world. And so, you know, we created a space where people just like, you can't talk to a fucking doctor about thinking the world is going to end, you know, but you can talk to a bunch of other people. What does it mean? What does it mean that there's a bunch of people who it's a common thing for people when they're in spiritual crisis, if we want to use that language, to think that they're messianic figures, you know, that they're meant to save the world. It's like this common archetype that plays itself out. Why is that? It's interesting. It's good to discuss these things. You know, we created forums like Give Me Lithium or Give Me Meth, where people could talk about their relationships to illegal drugs. Because, you know, quite often people's relationships to their mental health issues is very wrapped up in drug use, you know? Like we're all trying to figure out how to survive in this world, and if we're lucky, we find the right tools to do it, you know? One of the things that we started from that I think is really important to, if you want to understand the work of the Icarus Project, is that we started from this place where we said, okay, if you take psychiatric drugs or you don't take psychiatric drugs, you're welcome here. You're totally welcome here. And if you use diagnostic categories to define yourself, like bipolar disorder or schizophrenia, or you think those categories are fucking bullshit, you're welcome here. And you know what happened? We got this like really interesting mix of all these different people with all these different ideas and life experiences, and we carved open a space where it was like, okay, yeah, maybe we've had different life experiences and we don't agree, you know? Like, for example, I'm someone who takes psychiatric meds and they seem to work really well for me. We could talk about that sometime if you want to. But I think that was the place that we started from. Then we ended up, like a year into it, we wrote this book called Navigating the Space Between Brilliance and Madness, where we basically just like took a bunch of writing that was written on our website from these like amazing people. We ended up becoming a magnet for really brilliant, visionary, artistic people who just like didn't fit in other places. And pretty quickly, we ended up getting a big grant to organize on college campuses. And we used it to write this little book called Friends Make the Best Medicine, A Guide to Creating Community Mental Health Support Networks. And both of these, by the way, you can download for free off of our website. And, you know, people have downloaded this more than 25,000 times, and it's been translated into a bunch of different languages. I was just reading the Spanish language version this morning that someone made in Spain. So what does the Icarus Project do? We make, you know, publications that people read. We create, like, basically what this thing is it's a guide for starting a local support group. And it gives you all these tools for if you want to get a bunch of people together and have conversations. It gives you facilitation techniques and all kinds of good questions to ask. And just like a lot of wisdom that from over the years, I'll tell you right now, just to understand the context, the people who started the Icarus Project, we're folks who came out of radical social justice movements. And so we had experience organizing and working with people and like, what does it take to get folks together? And I'll tell you, like 12 years later, it's like kind of wild that it's been 12 years, but there's something you learn a lot when you work with folks who, like, you know, struggle with extreme states of consciousness. You know, it's like it can be challenging, and I think it's like Sera, you know, we're actually very explicit that we are changing the world. I mean, that's like, you know, I feel like for me, just like a person walking around every day, what keeps me going, in fact, is that I have a sense. Maybe it's a story I tell myself. Maybe that's what, you know, maybe it's just, it's a narrative. But I feel like I'm part of something much bigger than myself, that I have a hand in creating. And that's what allows me to be able to, like, I don't know, get up and do the stuff I gotta do every day. So I feel like, I don't know any of you, but I don't know what you do with your lives every day. But I'll tell you, like, feeling like you're connected to a whole bunch of other people, that's what we do with the Icarus Project. Basically, we try and we're part of you know, building a radical social justice movement that, like, you know, the last thing I'll say is that, you know, it was actually, I keep looking at this drawing of Martin Luther King Jr. over there. There's this quote of his that I learned from a guy named David Oakes from an organization called Mind Freedom. I don't know if you've ever heard this, but Martin Luther King Jr. said on a number of occasions, human salvation lies in the hands of the creatively maladjusted. You know, and I feel like we're a bunch of creatively maladjusted folks, you know, trying to do our part to change things.
And I want to say that I feel incredibly honored to be with these two really amazing people who are, you know, doing such amazing things, for lack of a better adjective. The last question is, what is your vision of what's needed in the mental health realm, and maybe beyond your own organization? What, you know, it's a pretty vague question, but
I take a stab.
Big questions for, yes, not a lot of time. So I guess one of the things I'll say is, so you watched a portion of the Beyond the Medical Model, I mean, maybe about 2/3, I think, and kind of missed the punchline, because you know how it starts with, this is not an anti-medical model film, and then you're probably thinking, oh yes, this is an anti-medical model film. But what you missed toward the end was it saying, this is not an anti-medical model film, this is an anti-model film. And having, you know, a string of people talk about how, you know, no one model completely makes sense for them, or they've had to make their own models or what have you. And I think that the most important thing that I'd like to see in this culture is not, you know, just, you know, I'm really not aiming to get rid of the medical model, whatever that really is, and replace it with the trauma model or what have you. I'm looking to have us be open to hearing each other's stories and each other's experiences and really learning from one another. There's something called intentional peer support. And, you know, I should say, I don't think anything is the end all be all, but I think there's pieces of greatness in lots of different things. And intentional peer support is one where it really just focuses on, I really want to spend time hearing where you're coming from and how you've learned about the world and your place in it. And if we could do that, and I know that's not the doctor's training, but I feel like there's ways to even bring it in there without saying, oh, in 10 minutes, I can tell you exactly where you came from, right? So I think that's one huge thing that needs to change. And I feel like we are a little bit trapped, unfortunately, in this system that is about money and advertising and pharmaceutical industries and health insurance industries and all these things. And I'm not totally sure how to get out from under the weight of that. But I think it's important that we think about it, because there's a lot of things that we believe that just aren't true in other countries. So if you ever watch Daniel Macker's film on Open Dialogue, there's a moment in it that I love, where Open Dialogue is this Northern Finland approach, and it is a clinical approach, but it's getting the best recovery rates in the world. And at one point he asks one of the clinicians, so do you ever fear for your license or for getting sued if you don't put people on medication, since that's considered best practice in Finland? And she just looks at him and she says, what? That's ridiculous. Where would you get that idea? Well, got that idea from our country, right? I mean, that's what would happen here. That's what does happen here. And this is also, this open dialogue system is also a place where people's lives are changed in part because they trust their system. They reach out for support much more quickly because they trust this system. How can we get to a place where we have resources and supports that we can trust? Because, you know, it's not about which model we choose or which approach is like absolutely the right approach. It's about how can we create opportunities for connection and for people feeling like it's safe to reach out and ask for support and connect with other people without some threat looming. So,
one thing that I've learned about this open dialogue approach in Finland, and it's now coming to a few places in the US, is that they have a team of professionals, of a nurse and a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a social worker, whatever, but several people that come and meet with the person and the family or whoever's important to them, and it's the same team for several years. Same team. Can you imagine in this country, and they might go every day or once a week or whatever to as much as needed. And that's so unheard of, to have any consistency, to have any like long-term or open-ended times.
All right, so here, I'll try and be the most useful I can as quickly as possible. So how many people here have ever heard of an advance directive? About half, maybe a little more. Okay, so an advance directive, it's a legal document that you write in the event that you can't make decisions for yourself. It's like a do not resuscitate. Like it's, you know, usually involves like grave medical stuff. So somewhere around a decade ago, there was a group of us at the Icarus Project that started getting really interested in the idea of what it would look like if, as a community, we could write maps about our lives, right? Like for ourselves and the other people, about, you know, what it looks like when we're well, how we know when we're doing well, and then what it looks like when we're having a hard time, and then what it looks like when we're in crisis, and then what are the things that trigger us, that make us have a hard time, and then what are the things we can do to make things better? There's a series of things like that. We started playing around with it in different configurations and started kind of adding art to it. And we basically came up with this thing that people in our community call Mad Maps. So flash forward like almost a decade, and there's a bunch of us that are now basically getting rooms full of people together and having these conversations about what does it look like when I'm healthy? Because we can talk, it's, you know, if we're gonna have a conversation about mental illness, what if we start with a conversation about how do I know when I'm well? What does it look like? What does it feel like in my body when I'm well? What kind of thoughts am I having in my head? You know, like what does it tangibly feel like? And the longer that I work on the Mad Maps project, the more in love with just trying to articulate these things and kind of drawing them out of other people are. And really what we're doing as a community is that we're creating our own, you know, there's this book, the DSM-5, which is like the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, that gets used to label us. And we're creating our own, it's like a people's DSM, you know? And I feel like, you know, there's the personal, how do I know when I'm well? But then there's also the questions of, what does it look like when things are well? You know, or like, what does it look like when the world is doing all right? You know, and then what are the warning signs that it's not doing so well? I think, like I said, I'm just trying to be practical. You asked this question about visions for the future, but I'm telling you, this is what I do every day. So you know, I have to say, one of the biggest challenges of trying to build a network like we're building is just that people have really different life experiences. We're all human, but there's like we have these commonalities, but then there's also just, you know, if like I can have my experience that I've been through, but if I was a black man or a black woman living here, I would have a really different life experience, you know? And I, like, if I was born, you know, in one place, but if I was like, and then you get a bunch of people in a room together who have different life experiences, and what ends up happening is that like people end up not understanding each other's life experiences. And so what we decided to do was we created, it's in mid-process right now, there's this Madness and Oppression Mad Map document. We're basically, we're talking about what are the forces that have affected us? What are the things that we've struggled with that have created, you know, the people that we are now? And how can we learn to talk about it? One of my coworkers, her name is Augustina Vidal, and she's from Argentina, and she was a little girl when the dictatorship was ending there. And so she's really interested in intergenerational trauma. She's really interested in like the things that happened before we were even born that we don't even know about that affect our mental health, you know? And think about the things that happened right here that, you know, before we were ever here. Think about what happened in this country. Like not that long ago, there were slaves. There were indigenous people that lived here that were killed. That we don't, they're not here anymore. But like, that affects our mental health as a society. Mm-hmm. And we have a hard time talking about that. We have a hard time wrestling with it. It's scary. It's like we don't have the language for it. So in conclusion, when I started off talking about, you know, how we have to change the language and culture of what gets called mental health and mental illness, that's a huge piece of it, is talking about oppression, is talking about like, the ways that we've, because that's like, you know, it's the only way we're going to be able to build bridges to a future. You can't, like, you know, Carl Jung talks about the shadow. Like, whatever the shadow is, I think about this all the time. Like, there's the stuff we're talking about, but what are we not talking about? And then how is that affecting us, you know? And like, so, I swear I could talk all night, but I'm going to shut up right now.
So now for discussion, and I neglected to get someone. Brian Troutman, are you still back there? I can't see. Would you be willing to do the mic?
That's fine. Yes.
Great. Okay. So we're gonna. Anyone who wants to speak, raise your hand. He'll come with the mic, and he's getting the mic first, and then we'll have a discussion between people, everyone in the audience, and the panelists.
This is to all three of you. I live in Rensselaer County, and occasionally I see flyers for something, Mental Health Project, which offers a place for people to call on the telephone when they feel something or other. I don't know if depressed or suicidal, but it's not a particularly nice term. And the time to call has a cutoff time in the evening, which is a bit early. And I thought, why isn't art people in every state trying to get funds so that in every county there's somebody, some team of people who could be 24 on 24, 7 on 7 days a week?
Let me
answering the phone.
There is someone from the Mental Health Empowerment Project here, and I think she'd like to say something. So she's right over there. So if you want to pass the microphone over.
Hi. My name is Lisa. I'm from the Empowerment Exchange. We're an offshoot of the Mental Health Empowerment Project. And yes, we do have a peer support line. And we're on from Friday until Saturday, 9 in the morning until 9 in the evening. And we find that very often we don't get calls in the evening. But I very much welcome your feedback, and I'm going to bring that back to my boss. And if I can get your contact info, or even just your name, I'll let her know that that there is somebody who is looking for.
I would be happy to volunteer.
Awesome. Yeah, and we are always looking for volunteers as well. Yeah, in the red.
Wait.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to call on people,
I just want to respond to that because there is a national suicide prevention hotline across the whole United States. I don't have the number offhand, but if you Google it, you can call 24/7, anybody in the United States.
And every time there's a comment, I'm going to give the panelists a chance to respond if you wish.
I guess I would say, I think one of the reasons that people aren't calling some of the peer-to-peer support lines, because we also have one, is people just still don't know in a lot of instances that they exist. And so that's part of the issue. I would love to have 24/7 option, even if it doesn't get used very often, simply because otherwise that pushes people into options. Frankly, most of the local emergency lines, you know, are really intended just to evaluate people to go to hospital or other clinical resources. Yeah, so I would love to. I think there are some national prevention lines. I guess I would just suggest you also do some research about those, because a lot of them, current research is suggesting, will track you, do have ways of tracking you, and will send police, et cetera, out. Actually, something came out very recently saying that most lines of that nature are tracked. So I don't mean the peer-to-peer support lines, I mean the national prevention lines, et cetera. So.
And I just wanted to say, when you call, I don't even know what your number is. I don't know where you are. You could be anywhere. And we do not send police to your house. Okay. Just saying.
Yeah, and we don't either. I mean the national prevention lines more so than the peer-to-peer lines.
So I'd like to have some questions that are directed as much as possible to the panelists, because we only have them for a short time.
Yes. Thanks. I'd like to ask either and both of you, Sascha and Sera, about co-optation. And part of the reason I'm thinking a lot about co-optation, because I'm in the midst of writing a chapter for a book about it, but it's also like what I see going on around me all over the place. And I think your group in particular does an excellent job of not being co-opted. And I'm assuming that's easy for the Icarus Project because you don't get funding from the mental health system not to be co-opted. But for people who are trying to take the system's money and do honorable work with good intent without stepping on people, how do you see it possible to avoid co-optation?
I think it's really tough, and I think, unfortunately, having been through these experiences ourselves does not necessarily mean that people kind of get it. Unfortunately, I see a lot of people who have been forced into the system and had really awful things happen to them turn around and get a job in the system and do some of those same things, and so I think that we need to not assume that just because you've had that experience, you're even starting from a place of understanding some of the complexities, some of what Sascha brought up about this history of oppression and all the things that are driving us. And in a lot of ways, it makes sense that someone who's felt like they've had no power might get a little bit of power and then kind of run with it and not really have had an opportunity to think through some of the implications. So some of it, I think, is about education around that. Some of it is about us being willing to lose some of that money. I think that's one of the things that helps us. We do get a tremendous amount of funding from state mental health, and I always approach it with a few different things. One is I always approach not asking questions. I approach them saying, here's what we're doing, and I'm not even asking you, I'm just telling you. Well, I'm just speaking to you as if, of course, this is what we're doing, because of course this is what we should be doing. This isn't a conversation. We just all know this is right. And if I approach them with that, often they go along with it, actually far more often than not. And I've also said to them when they've pushed back on something, yeah, well, I need to, you know, think about this and talk with other people and figure out if that's a deal breaker for us. And I've said those words over and over again. I mean, I shouldn't say over and over, because it actually, we've been fairly successful, but whenever it's been that situation, that's what we've said. And most of the time we've kind of gotten our way. We undercut ourselves so quickly. So many people undercut themselves by trying to figure out what people are going to try and take from them or what they want them to do, and then they try and move to that without ever trying to not. And I think we have to be ready to really push those limits and support one another and be better connected with one another so that we feel like we have the strength to do that.
So I have an answer. I have a very different answer, and I hope it's useful, and at the least, I hope it's entertaining. So, because I've actually spent a lot of time thinking about this. No, I think a lot about strategy, about how it is that we're going to change things. There, you can look throughout history. Here's the best way I can say it. It's like this metaphor from, you know, a lot of the metaphors from Icarus come from the fact that the folks who started it worked on farms and spent a lot of time in the woods. So, if you're growing a garden, This is about co-optation. So if you're growing a garden, there's the topsoil and the subsoil, and the topsoil is full of micronutrients and organic matter. The subsoil is full of micronutrients. Most plants stay in the topsoil. Try and follow this, even though it's like this weird agricultural metaphor. There's a good punchline. Most plants stay in the topsoil, and then there's some plants that have deep tap roots that go down into the subsoil, pull up nutrients from the subsoil, and then die and end up in the topsoil. There's this like relationship between the topsoil and the subsoil. I'm really interested in how to keep things radical, how to keep things from getting co-opted. And I think that often the strategy is, because the way you change things is you have to get into the mainstream. That's the only way that you do it. And inevitably, when you get into the mainstream, you end up getting co-opted. It's just part of the deal. You get watered down. You can't hold on to really radical ideas. But I think it's really important to remember that there need to be the radical ideas and places for them. And that's kind of what the Icarus Project does. You can't really co-opt us. But I sure hope that our ideas end up in the mainstream. So... I'm hoping that my sense is that like there's like, okay, this is where it comes from actually, is that I grew up in the punk scene in New York, and I grew up playing in punk rock bands. And then I was a teenager when punk rock got really popular, and all of a sudden bands that I was into were like on the cover of Rolling Stone. And it did very strange things to the scene that I was a part of. It was like a really weird, it ended up shifting the dynamics a lot. But there were like a fuck ton more people who knew all the songs that, you know, I knew. But then it wasn't ours anymore. And And so I think that there's something about the system is never going to say like, oh yeah, we need to create like radical anti-oppression, like mad maps that are going to, you know, get people talking to each other. No, that's not what's going to happen. But what's going to happen is that the more people that in a grassroots way start adopting language and changing it and using it, it'll shift around. The last thing I'll say is like, we put out this harm reduction guide to coming off psych drugs, and maybe someone in the crowd has the one copy of it that I left over there. A few years after we put it out, the American Psychiatric Association put out their own version. You know? Like, basically, it was like, you do the right thing, and eventually they realize, oh, shit, those people did it. We have to do it, too. So different kind of answer.
Yes, over there.
Regarding being co-opted, how are you funded?
Good question. Small private foundations that are like, it turns out that, you know, they're like, the thing is that mental illness goes across class lines. And so there's a lot of people, you know, who have a lot of money whose kids are diagnosed bipolar. And so, you know, we cultivate like, you know, there's like a small amount of people who fund us to do the work that we're doing. We have a pretty small budget, you know. But if you start getting something in your email asking for money from us soon, that means that we actually are getting our shit together and starting a grassroots fundraising campaign.
Can I just add one thing? You know, if you're in this world at all, getting different funders is huge, because then you can always say, no, I'm using their money for that, right? It's a really important strategy.
Yeah.
Yeah, here and then there and then here. Okay.
I was interested in hearing more about your community, particularly the house, the alternative to hospitalization. And I'm also wondering, how do you do outreach? And how many people are in your community? How many people do you work with? And what's your feeling about medication? And
it's a lot of questions. Okay, so
a few hours.
As far as medication goes, we take a similar approach as what Sascha described around Icarus Project, which is, you know, you're welcome any way that you come. However, we also see a responsibility to make sure that when you come, there's lots of information for you to actually, you know, figure out, did you have all the information, whatever decision you've made to be on medication, to change medication, to get off of medication, is that based on being informed? Because most people who are just out in the world are not getting that information. So we really feel we have a real responsibility to make sure that people get that information. And then we support them in their decision. And so as far as our community goes, it's pretty large and diverse. We have a lot of information over there that may be helpful. We have some newsletters and calendars that will give you an idea to some degree of what it looks like. And we're not that far if people want to come check us out. But we have 4 resource centers in 4 different parts of Western Mass. We have community bridgers that will go into hospitals and connect with people and help them transition back to the community and advocate with them while they're there. We have lots of hearing voices groups and alternatives to suicide groups. We have free yoga and acupuncture and all these different things going on. And then we have the house as well. And what's great about having a community in this way is that people can connect however they want to. There are people who are part of our community who might just go to yoga every week, or people who might just be, you know, I don't know, watching our films and then calling our peer support line, or going to the house. And you don't have to be, I think one of the problems with the hospital or the clinical respites is you have to be in a particular place to have that connection. And with our community, you can be wherever you are, doing great, doing really not great, and have a connection. And that's really, really helpful. I'm not sure what else I can share with you, or if you have particular questions about the house, but you know, I think I have no way of answering how many people, because we don't keep records, We don't ask people to sign in anywhere. We keep some degree of numbers, but we don't have names attached. So many of us have histories that are awful of having files following us around, and it just really increases the power dynamic. You know, if I'm gonna have a file on you or keep track of you, why aren't you getting to keep track of me? We just don't do it. So what I can tell you is, we send out our email newsletter to over 2,000 people every month. We send even more paper newsletters out, and we see a lot of people, and we have a lot of connections, and people get to define what those connections look like from day to day.
Do you ever encounter someone that you feel could be dangerous to others?
I mean, there are lots of people. I mean, in one of our centers that is in a particularly urban area, half the people who are coming through there every day are living without a home and living without a food and in really desperate situations. And, you know, I mean, sometimes people who are in desperate situations who've been really hurt, you know, are inclined to do things to survive, you know? So how would I even begin to assess? I would say that some of those people we're aware of in the world, in other parts of the world, have done things that have gotten them in trouble. Some of that's about race. Some of that's, it's so many different things. How are we defining dangerousness? How are we defining any of that? Do I see people, you know, I don't know. What I can tell you is we create a community where we ask everybody, no matter how difficult of a situation you're in, no matter how desperate you are for food or home or how many voices that are distressing to you right now that you're hearing, we ask you to hold our values. And by creating a community where everyone's being asked to hold values, we have found that people hold those values or are at least willing to say to someone else who's not, hey, you're not holding those values, we're going to ask you to not be in the space today. And so 7 years, for the most part, we haven't had anything bad happen, with one exception that I'll just say really briefly. That one exception at our respite house, we had one violent incident last May, and the assumption from the outer world was, oh, this must have been someone who's doing stereotypical crazy things you see on the news and all the media, and God, if you only had clinicians there, it would have been prevented. The truth is that person came to us through a clinician that had assessed them, that said, hey, we don't think you should be here, go over here. And that person was trying to steal a car to leave the state, and that's when something bad happened. It was for none of the stereotypical reasons, and it involved a clinician. So, I don't know.
I just want to point out that I don't know if you have this here, the Western Massachusetts Recovery Learning Community Defining Principles. It's very informative. I would suggest you get it off the website. Those questions were directed at Sera, right? Yeah. I think you're next, Chris.
Yeah. Here we go.
There's so much I appreciate what you shared. I'm just thrilled. I don't really want to use a mic. Can you hear me? I think someone turned me on to Icarus Project a few years ago through art, that an artist that's involved with your work, and I can't remember her name. It was just beautiful work. And I didn't know about your place, and I wish I did a few months ago, because a friend of mine is now in a residence outside of Baltimore. She's actually doing great because she's in this like amazing like resort-like place that is going to bankrupt her, but that's where she chose to go. She had gotten TMS, which is, I don't know if you've heard of this TMS treatment, which is it's a magnetic treatment for depression, and that had really helped her. But then after she had surgery, you know, intense surgery, she decompensated, like, so, like, she got depressed so badly, like, she was so, she got suicidal in a way that she had never experienced before, and it scared the shit out of her. And the local system failed her so miserably that it terrified her. And then she just got, like, worse. So she ended up going to a completely different place, out of New York, couldn't find anything within New York. And she had good insurance, and she had advocacy skills, and she had privilege. And she couldn't find a single place in the state of New York that would really meet her where she was at and make her feel safe. So I applaud what you're both doing, and I work at the Coalition Against Sexual Assault. My project's called Building Connections, and it's about sexual assault and mental health. And it's also about all of this that we're talking about. And I, you know, watching the film, like, oh, so maybe I am bipolar because everything's connected to me. Like that image where, like, everything's like, you know, you see this and you see that and everything's connected. It's like, yeah, that's been my life. But somehow I escaped the diagnosis because I had a family that was extremely paranoid about the medical model. Because I actually got misdiagnosed with a seizure disorder when I was young. And they you know, I was lucky that that's all it was. So it's a seizures disorder, and Dilantin was like something I could get off of pretty quick. But I just want to say, like, there's so much that they don't know, and yeah, I kind of almost want to say I do want to replace the medical model with the trauma model, but I get that it's not doesn't have to be either or. If we could do some, if doctors and medical people could just acknowledge that they don't know, we could be so much more cooperative and complementary. And so one of my questions is WRAP, your Wellness Recovery Action Plan. Yeah. You know, to me, that's like kind of similar to the Mad Maps, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So did yours come first? No.
No, WRAP came first.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Mm-hmm. So do you find that that's compatible for folks? Because I like the idea of the maps, that it's more visual.
Yeah, that's a thing. So for those who don't know, WRAP, Wellness Recovery Action Plan, Mary Ellen Copeland, really inspiring work, similar to what I'm talking about. But the thing is that it's a cultural thing, kind of, you know, like the people in our community were just like, what? They was using this medical language,
exactly.
And, you know, so we changed the language, we put art in it, and then we started talking about oppression.
Yeah.
There's no social context in rap.
Exactly. Yeah, because that's why it never spoke to me, I guess. I have friends that have used it, and I've recommended it as a tool, but for myself and my peers, like in my close circle, I've never tried it, because it must be the language. So I'd like to check out your maps. And I guess the last question was, like, if you know any way in your house, like the houses in Northampton, they're not residences, correct? It's like a place for drop-in, or do people live there that need support?
We have centers where people can come in during open hours and just connect, or the peer-to-peer support line, or a number of things in the community. The respite house is three people can stay there at a time.
Three.
And
okay.
Yeah, they need to connect with people at the house and talk through whether it's a good fit, and then everyone makes that decision about, you know, does this seem like a right fit for you together?
Because I'd love to see that replicated all over the place.
There's something somewhat similar called Rose House out here. So New York does have.
In the Hudson Valley.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Just, Sarah, please say the towns that your centers are in for people.
So our centers are in Springfield, Holyoke, Greenfield, and then Pittsfield is the closest one to here. And then we have a number of things just going on in community in Northampton and different communities. We also have a lot of big events. We really see this changing the world thing as needing to not just involve people who are experiencing distress or have experienced distress. We want to involve everybody. And so in the spring, for instance, we have Eleanor Longden, who is big in the Hearing Voices movement in the UK. You can see a TED Talk with her. She'll be coming out and talking in the spring. In April, we have a psychiatrist from England coming out who talks about some cool perceptions he has around kids and ADHD and all this stuff. You know, have a lot of events like that, trying to get everybody in the room to dialogue with one another.
And I'll just say that I did go for both a seminar on withdrawing from drugs and the 4-day training on facilitating hearing voices group, and they were both really good.
And the alternatives to suicide group I'm in right now, amazing, so inspiring. They're doing really good work.
One last point, because there's at least two other people with hands up.
I just wondered if you both have used drum circles and drumming as a therapeutic, you know, fun way of connecting, because it's something that Tracy's experienced recently with me. I lead drum circles in the community, and it wasn't mentioned in the film as like one of the tools that people could do, but just curious.
We've certainly had that in our community. We have a drumming workshop going on right now. We've had drum making workshops. We've had drum circles. It makes me a little, I don't know what the word is, it's not good for me, so I don't personally use it. But we do have it in our community.
Before we go to people, I think you have your hand up, is that right? Do you still have your hand up? Is there anyone else? Okay, so I said Greg would be first, so let's hear from him, and then back here, okay, and then the other people.
Okay, I'm from the 60s, so first of all, I just wanted to say, power to the people! Man, you're inspiring, and these are things I think of. If we're not here to help each other, who the hell are we here for? And that's what you folks are saying. And in my own life, listening to a Bruce Springsteen song, if we can't help our family, we just ain't no good. And the medical model, the psychiatric model, sets us up as if we're enemies with our own blood. And they encourage us to incarcerate them, put them in the fucking hospital, contain them, drug them, fuck them up. And what the hell good is that? Are we any good if they're our enemies? And I just don't know. It just gets me pissed off. And power to the people. Because we're talking to people here. We're talking to people that care about other people. And what about the people who have autism? And what about the people that we didn't even talk about today? You mentioned seizure disorders, other things. These people are different. They have something that is different, different to offer. You're including that, thankfully. But there's a lot of, these people just don't fit because we're not willing to accept that or whatever reason. And I don't know, I'm just frustrated as hell. And I appreciate hearing your voice. And power to the people, thank you.
Well, I think the woman back there, yes. Well, there were two here too. Yeah, we'll get to you.
I don't know how I can top power to the people, but. I was actually surprised and disappointed to hear that the mental health professions are not looking at trauma. I work in the AIDS and HIV field, and we talk about trauma all the time. It doesn't get removed. It's part of most people's experiences, and we have to recognize that that's part of the healing and recovery. But aside from that, my question is, I know that both of you shared stories about your onset of emotional health crisis when you were adolescents or rather young. And I was just curious about your thoughts about possibly recommending for schools or for institutions that work with young adults assessments, emotional assessments, so that if there is an issue or if there is a moment where you can identify dealing with emotions and life and situations. I have a teenage daughter, and sometimes I could see that she gets really, she goes from 0 to 100 sometimes, and I'm seeing how she's responding to her life, and sometimes I feel it's important that I do get an assessment for her. But I just was curious what your thoughts were about that as a tool to possibly either work outside the medical model or to be responsive.
Thank you.
So, assessments as they exist in our culture terrify me. I have a 3-year-old and an 11-year-old, and when I went to my 11-year-old's school orientation this year, I walked straight into a sign that said, "Got ADHD? Justin Timberlake does." And I'm like, okay. And the year before, when I was driving my son to the movies on weekend, I was asking him about school, and he told me that the guidance counselor had been talking to him that maybe he should be considering distraction meds. And I'm like, wow. It's like, and one other thing I will tell you, when my son was, I'm learning a lot with him, but when he was, I think, 8 or 9, I went to the doctor's office for his well child visit, and found myself filling out a form that I very quickly realized was a mental health screener, and I stopped filling it out. And I told the doctor I wasn't going to fill it out. And he said, okay, well, you know, I get paid for those, but I can accept not getting paid for that. Like, holy crap. Wow. Like, the problem with assessments or screens as they exist is they are a mechanism to drive people into the system. So that terrifies me. The initiatives that are underway to put that into our school systems terrifies me. Now, if we could find better ways to just talk to our kids and say, hey, you know, what's going on? If we could find, you know, we really want to start an alternatives to suicide group for young people where they could talk in that way. I think those things are so important and for the most part, pretty lacking at the moment. Schools are really lacking in any sort of understanding of how to approach this. So I think it's really important, but we've got to do it the right way or else we're just creating the next generation of what we don't want.
I just read today that about 1 in 5, 20% of boys, teenage boys, are on ADHD drugs. And the rate of it's kind of a gateway to a bipolar diagnosis, being on those drugs. So it's pretty tragic.
So it's wild that you asked this question, because I was today in this training with 27 other people, and the question of assessment came up, and just the language of assessment. Now picture the scene. I'm in a room full of people who have all been in the psychiatric system, you know, and have been like, and have different associations. People have very negative associations with the word assessment. You know, what you just saw from Sera Davidow, that was like nothing compared to like, you know, what I saw today. Now, the reason I say it's wild is that my reply was, you know, assessment in and of itself is actually very important. We're constantly making assessments. We make assessments all day. And I think the question is, what are the diagnostic tools we're using to make them? I lived in the Bay Area of California for a bunch of years, and there's, I trained with this group called Generative Somatics, who they're social justice activists who mix somatic, like body-based therapy. And for them, assessment is really important, but they're somatic assessments. You're looking at someone's, like how they're holding themselves, you know? How are they breathing? What does their skin tone look like? You know, are they like, and so I feel like I want to be a part of trying to create, you know, like trying to figure out what the good assessments are that we can use and kick out this, you know, biopsychiatric garbage of labeling our kids. But like, yeah, assessment, your teenage daughter trying to figure out like what's going on with her, of course having good tools to do it. But don't trust the school system or the government to assess your daughter. That's all I'm gonna say.
Okay, everyone who's interested in speaking, raise your hand, please. Okay.
What time is it?
It's like 20 after 9. Okay.
Another 10 minutes,
so
please.
I'll just ask people to be brief. I guess we'll take you, and then we'll take you, and then we'll go over here and take some people.
I was very interested in the third film that talked about episodic mental illness and spiritual crises, because I wasn't diagnosed bipolar until I was in my 50s. And it was at a time of life, actually I attribute it to Zoloft, because I was in a deep depression, and then felt great, and then felt super great, and I was gonna rule the world. And I've been diagnosed bipolar ever since. But listening to that film especially, I was struck by the idea that these episodes can just be episodes and then disappear. And I wondered if any of you had any comments about that, especially as related to aging. I'm still on meds, but I think I may have edged out of them, aged out of them, maybe.
One thing I'll say that I don't know if it will exactly get at what you're saying, but it's reminding me of it. If we go back to the open dialogue system, one of the things that they have accomplished is almost eliminating the diagnosis of schizophrenia. And the reason that they have done that is it used to be quite high, but in order to get a diagnosis of schizophrenia, you need...
Mine was bipolar.
Right, I understand. Okay. But you need to have the symptoms for more than 6 months. Oh. And based on the way they're interacting with people and the responses they're having, they are seeing people move through in less than 6 months, and therefore the diagnosis okay. isn't being given. Yeah. And I think it's true, I think they're finding that it's true with all the diagnoses, bipolar included, that based on responses, sort of like what that quote said, if you don't get in the way of something, if you don't stop the process of something, for some people anyway, it can just be a moment in their life. So I'm not sure if that gets at what you were saying, but I think that it has so much to do with how we're supporting one another to move through rather than getting stuck.
I've had a request. It's been a very long day for the speakers who have come a long way from Holyoke and Massachusetts. So sadly, we have to end it. I think you'll have like a couple of minutes if you want to buy either of the films and as they pack up. And thank you, everyone. We're also losing a lot of our audience. So thank you so much for coming. If you didn't sign in, find the sign in by the door, and I hope to see you all again.